Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm your host, Richard DeCastro, here at the Speak Your Mind Show. After a small hiatus, I took a little time out to enjoy some of the culture of the Virgin Islands, going across to the U.S. Virgin Islands, and but that is St. Thomas and St. John. And back here with you, with the Speak Your Mind Show, you know, live broadcast. Also on www.jtvlive.net. So if you have any persons who don't have cable and they need to watch the show, just remind them that they could always go to, using the internet that is, go to www.jtvlive.net and you can pick up the show at that point as well. We're having a live show here. We're going to introduce a couple of topics. Of course, we're going to talk about water. We're going to talk about jobs. And we're going to talk about the Freedom of Information Act. And we're going to also talk a little bit about some of the construction work that's going on in the territory. Of course, these are all topical things. So, you know, if you know a friend who might be not listening at this time, maybe you might want to call them up and remind them that the Speak Your Mind Show is on, and this is the place where we communicate. When I say communicate, I'm speaking about two-way communication here, where, you know, I'm using the media to talk to the Virgin Islands community about things that are happening in our community and come up with suggestions, modifications, ideas, all of the above that would reflect on how, you know, how we interact with each other in these Virgin Islands. It's lively, and it's educational, and it's also, oh, before I forget too, we're going to mention about the accreditation of the H. Loudy Stout Community College and what that means to our community. Our community, of course, meaning from Annie Gatter to Josh Van Dyke. And may I remind my viewers out there that I want to hear from the Sister Islands as well. The issues on the Sister Islands are very important to us. We are, you know, striving to be one community more and more. So we have to address the various Sister Island issues. We know them off the bat. Right away, we know what they are. We have people on Sister Islands who feel that they should be treated fairly and unequal to people here on the big island of Tortola. That means access, whether it's by ferry boat or plane or whatever, you know, proper access, proper health care, you know, availability to pay their taxes, get the licenses in place and all the things that citizens would like to have, you know, while they're at home. You know, there's no place like home, and home is where you make it. So if you're at home, most of us would like to believe that we could get all of those services while we're at home. I know for some of my colleagues, just to change a check, you have to jump on a boat, come to Tortola, etc., etc. In other words, you have to incur expenses just to do normal business practices. So the more we can speak about these things and make them easier for the average citizen, I think that is where we'll be considering ourselves moving in strides. You know, as the good athletes usually say, you know, if you have, you've got your running shoes on, you can run. And if you're running, You're definitely not walking. You're making strides. We need to move. We need to, you know, make some strides and move things further along. That's what I think. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, I'm here with you, and remember, the show is open. We have the numbers up there, 300-1949 if you're going to call, and 300-1950 if you're going to text. So we're here, I'm here, and I'm going to be with you, and we're going to, like I said, we're going to put some issues out there. We're going to talk a bit about freedom of information, the act that we're patiently waiting on, especially the media. We've seen some hiccups in the media, and we would like to move on from those hiccups. So the freedom of information. Some people may be saying, wait, what is DiCastro talking about freedom of information in 2015? Let me tell you one of the side effects of not having a freedom of information bill. Right next door in the US Virgin Islands, you see the one of the local newspapers lobbying the government to get information on somewhere like about 15 to 20 different issues. And they have it well documented when they asked for the information, what reply they got, and what action the government did or didn't do. And some of it is very mundane. Some of it is the asking description of jobs. They're asking, who is being paid, what are the salaries of some of the people. You know, basic information that a citizen should know, because it's taxpayers' dollars that is being spent. And as a person in the media, when to go on a live broadcast and talk about various issues, you first need to do a minimum of I would say 50 to 75% research in the area. And the only way you can properly research is if you have access to information, or else you may have to do what some of the media end up doing here, which is really not really reporting. They're just cut and pasting the information that is put out, sometimes verbatim, I mean word for word. I think that is unfortunate, but that is a result, in my opinion, of when, there's not a clear framework on how the media can access information, or the inability of the media to access information in a timely manner too. Remember, we're living in the 21st century, so it doesn't make sense sending me information that's 2 weeks old, 2 months old on an issue. As it happened, we're internet savvy people. We have most of the information that is made in the Virgin Islands. Correct me if I'm wrong on this one, but I'm going to say it again. Most of the information that is made in the Virgin Islands is made in a digital media format. Let me explain myself. When stuff is typed on a computer, that is digital media format, because it's being saved digitally. When minutes are taken, and they're taken in a word processing program, they're being stored electronically. That is the same type of media. So to get information from that media to the print media is a process that's a very old process, and we all know how that works. It's the final stage in some instances. However, once something is in a digital media format, to put it onto the internet, or to use it in another electronic format, is pretty straightforward. And there are programs for translation, etc., etc. So it's not rocket science. So since that is the case, I think we wouldn't want any secrets. We wouldn't want any government secrets out there, and we wouldn't want any military, exercises and that kind of, anything that would be a danger to the country. But believe you me, there's a lot of information that is out there that is public information. Information which was made in the public interest. Taxpayers paid for the office space. Taxpayers paid for the time that the officers were involved. I mean, it goes on and on and on and on. It is public information. And once it is not sensitive information that would put persons at a disadvantaged position, and I'm sure that the government would ensure that that does not happen. However, there is a certain amount of public information that is necessary for us to have proper decision making in the public. I'm not talking about at the government level. I'm talking about at the public level. And while we're talking about that, ladies and gentlemen, I think it's time we also look at some of the other issues here. The election of other things other than just politicians. Instead of just 13 members to represent the government, we probably need to look at other areas where we can elect people to do things in the community. I know in other countries, judges are elected, magistrates are elected, school board members are elected. There's a number of other things. You know, it's not just the political House of Assembly is elected, but there are other positions that can become elected. A supervisor of election could be an elected position. However, we would have to change the way how we do business. It wouldn't be business as usual. I have a text. Let me see what's on the text board here. So, good night. Speak your mind. I would like to see more work done in the area of Elevator Hill at Sikaos Bay before the rainy season starts. The person that texted in, I agree with you, although I saw some people walking there Friday. I too would like to see, as a matter of fact, if we're going to talk about that, when I was passing there, someone commented to me and said, they asked me if what I was doing is sufficient. And I said, well, I'm one of those persons who would have to wait and see, since we're not in the mode, where we have a process where we come up with a design and we come to the community and we explain to the community what we're doing, and then we go out and we execute it. We're in the fast track mode where we go then we execute a project, and then if something is wrong, and you know, somebody like myself on speaking mind says something negative about it, it's taken as if we're against the project. So, you know, that's not a good amen at all. That's not good for good design practice. I think there are enough people in this community with enough experience and knowledge that can assist this community without costing the government. As a matter of fact, I don't think it would cost the government to be just to be open and, you know, take ideas and suggestions from the community. There are many people here who are retired here, who have worked in other places in many, many different capacities, who can offer service. I know of some of them who offered their service and were blatantly refused. But be that as it is, I think they would still offer their services, and the whole community would benefit from it, because no one man knows everything. I take that text as positive as well, because that is a tremendous amount of water comes down a hill from the Treadfall to Sikaos Bay area. And if the drain isn't fixed properly, then the water stays on the road, and with the vehicles passing on the road would be destroyed. So, I wasn't finished. After the road is destroyed, government would have to rebuild the road again. And this was done a few times already. So we're hoping that, you know, that the solution that's being done there is a good solution, and that it is fruitful. That is, you know, it doesn't cause another repair and another redesign, so to speak. But it was done poorly, in my opinion. So any effect, any fix to fix it is an attempt, I think, to resolve the problem. However, I'm going to stick to my original solution, that You know, when we have these projects, and not just Sika Uzbek projects, I mean, any project in the territory, it is good practice. And I'm referring to framework because I work for an organization where most projects were put in a framework. And the framework is pretty simple. You have a design, you have community meetings, you have input from various stakeholders, and you take all the information that you get and you complete your design based on the feedback that you get from these various individuals. And then you come back to the community and say, this is what we're going to do. After all the consultations were done, all the consultants paid, and all the design options weighed, this is what we're going to do, and that's the way forward. I think we should really consider a format like that for future projects, so that you get what we call in my profession buy-in by the various stakeholders. And ladies and gentlemen, I think that's something that we as a community must take on more seriously and get more involved on an individual level to ensure that we get better value for the dollars that we're spending. One, that we have we have a broader feel to get ideas from, and also better buy-in by the stakeholders. We all know the stakeholders in the territory. If we're doing anything that's tourism oriented, we know the stakeholders are the hotels, the small inns and cottages, the taxi operators, the ferry operators. These are all people who are, how should I say, intimately interested, very much concerned about the future, about the industry. So they would be very interested in having an input into the decision-making part of the whole process. I even think that they would do it willingly, if you ask me. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, we're here with the Speaking Mind Show. I have another text that came in. Let's see what the text says. It said, there is not. Well, I think that might have been a comment to something that I said, but I hope it's not to the process of where we're exposing ideas and getting opinion from various stakeholders. I hope that's not what the text that came in is saying, because I think that's not a vibrant way to develop projects, you know. And also, I might mention too with the availability of information on the various internet places. Before there was the internet, and you're working on something, you would probably have to go and purchase a number of books, and hire a number of consultants in various areas, etc., and look at best practice from India and China and a number of other places. Now, you can basically go to a number of different places. For example, if you're working on something and you feel that Massachusetts Institute of Technology might have the answer to what you're looking for, you could go directly to their website, find the person that you need to email that person, and you can get a dialogue with a person, and you can move on from there. The world has become a lot smaller as a result of being able to access the various universities and schools and institutions. Just in a matter of a day's work. So we need to take this whole project framework thing to another level and develop it to a much more comprehensive way. But ladies and gentlemen, I said we were going to talk about water, jobs, accreditation, HLSCC, freedom of information. So On the issue of water, I think we have to continue to encourage our citizens to be mindful that we are experiencing a very difficult period at this time where water is concerned. And what I'm referring to we haven't had that much rain. Let me see, I just have another text that came in here. Bear with me, ladies and gentlemen. When will we have a leader of opposition? Do you think Honorable Fari has a chance? Well, you're asking me directly. I think that things like the leader of the opposition are going to have to work themselves out. It's just a matter of time. We're seeing a scenario develop and play out where the governor is saying that he gave them a month and a day, and I think that is soon to run out. And I am personally of the opinion, as it is, that we have enough people in this country with overqualified and with enough education, experience, knowledge, etc., to hold most of the positions that we have. I don't subscribe to the philosophy that we have a few, a bare minimum people in our society who could run this country. I do not believe that for a second. I am preaching to you out there that I think that in my lifetime, this is the most educated this country has ever been, in terms of the number of persons who have been educated to the associate level, the bachelor level, the master's level, even the doctorate level. This is the first we have ever had so many persons so well educated. And I am saying, and I hope that other people out there agree with me, that this is the first time that we have found ourselves in such a dilemma. And it seems to the detriment rather than to the a positive move. And I think we need to turn that around and do what is right. Entrust more in our people. Put more trust and faith in our people who have put themselves out there to represent the country. We have to agree that the ones that won, the ones that lose, all together, they're the ones that made a sacrifice of trying to make this place a better place. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, I'm saying to you that I think we have more than enough knowledge, experience, wisdom out there that we're going to be okay. We're not going to be the laughing stock of the Caribbean community. Ladies and gentlemen, we're having a wonderful show. We're getting some texts. Some calls would be great as well. But at this time, we're going to have to take a break for the sponsors that make the show possible. So I'll be right back with you. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, I'm back with you after a short break. We were here talking about some topical issues in the territory. I want to raise another one, and it's the transfer of technology when we're doing major capital works. And I wanted to just share with you some of the stuff that I think should go on when we're talking about transfer of technology. We have a situation here where the company Bywater has put up some plants, and one in Parakita Bay and one down at Bird Point, down below Fort Bird Corner. And what I'm showing you here is some video of the pipeline that is being put under the ground, and it's being done by what you call a horizontal directional drill. And this drill drills, there's a view of the drill there. It drills under the ground, under the drain, etc., And then the bigger pipe that you just saw there, the black pipe, is sleeved in without having to dig up the plants and the sidewalk and the roadway. So this is new to the territory, and I think there should be more of this type of transfer of technology, you know, properly document what is being done, so that when we have to do stuff like this in the future, we can then you know, continue this type of operation. It's less evasive to the traffic, right? The traffic still, you can see traffic still moving along. And it is new technology to us, but it's been around for a while. And this is part of Bywater's contract with the government. And it is being done right now to complete the installation from the roundabout where government, the Water and Sewage Department, has a major pumping station. And that is going, this pipeline is going to be able to take the effluent from there all the way down to the treatment plant down at Bird Point. And ladies and gentlemen, yes, for the first time, we're going to have tertiary treatment on sewage before it goes into the water, the sea, that is. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, I think that, as I was saying earlier, we must look at these projects from a project framework point of view. And part of this whole framework should be the transfer of technology, where, you know, persons on the study part of the process, so that when we have to do it again a second time, we're the ones doing it rather than having someone else do it. So I thought I'd just put that out there as part of this whole talk about jobs and how we're moving in terms of, you know, the framework of doing proper project proposals, management, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I have a text that came in. I see what the community is saying. It says, there's no drug police presence in Road Town. Too many drivers are parking in no parking zones. The person that texted, I wonder about that as well. And I have seen some situations where the same information that you have, the questions on the licensing, when you're going to get a license, the same questions that you and I and everybody else have to answer to get a license, I'm seeing some of those same things being violated. And it seems as if that it's not being properly monitored and properly enforced. So I would agree with you, especially around town where there's minimal parking in some cases. Sometimes there's no parking. But I am hopeful that this situation will get corrected as we move on and have a dialogue about it. I am prepared to have a full dialogue about it in the coming weeks. Yeah, there must be reasons why some of these things are going in the way they are going. And I always, when I get that kind of comment from the public, I always refer back to the Constitution. The 2007 Constitution makes a provision for a committee of persons to look after the well-being of the country in a security council. And this security council is comprised of persons like the commissioner of police and the premier and a number of other persons who are supposed to meet together and decide strategy on how to fight crime and make enforcement more transparent, etc., etc. And I am hoping that with that kind of direction, the small issues that the person that texts and I would pick up on would be, you know, those would be small things that would be, you know, mundane or easily dealt with, rather than the much bigger issues. I am yet to hear what is our policy on you know, on various issues when it comes to, you know, what is the strategy that we are using. I'm yet to hear a comprehensive report to the public, or a report to the public, I should say. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, this month of July is, the police has an amnesty on weapons. So please do the right thing, turn in your weapons. And ladies and gentlemen, I might be speaking a little bit out of turn here, but I know that there was some new legislation made that now include other firearms like pellet guns, flare guns, paint guns. So if you don't have these guns licensed, my advice to you would be to turn them in or seek to get them licensed. One of the two. But while there's an amnesty, I think you should take advantage of the amnesty. I don't know all the details of how the amnesty work, but how I think it should work, I'm going to say. I think you should, I think if you turn in the weapons, they don't usually ask you any questions. They just take the weapons and note that they took the weapons. So if that is the case, you know, you have a good opportunity now to get rid of some unwanted weapons that you may have. And ladies and gentlemen, this includes ammunition as well. So do the right thing and make the place much more safe for all of us. But back to the original thing what we were talking about, which is, you know, the strategy, the PR, the whole policy of how we're dealing with the situation. I think we need to have a dialogue about it, and I can be a facilitator, but I think there must be buy-in by persons at that top level, at the highest level, in order for the whole community to agree and cooperate. You know, that's what I think. I think we need that type of cooperation in our community. So that's my take on that whole scenario. I still feel that the traffic licensing department and the police traffic department need to have regular dialogue and find ways to improve their communication. And I must again big up the say kudos to the traffic licensing department. I think that they've made some serious steps to improve. And I mentioned one the last time I was here. I was talking about the fact that now the sticker that goes on your windshield has the information about your vehicle. It has your license plate on it, and it has the type of vehicle it is. So it makes it much more difficult for persons to violate the traffic regulations. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, that is a positive move. And I also noticed that using the services down at Parkwood Pond has become a bit more transparent and quicker. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, we have some improvements in this community. And that is always a good thing, because doing business in the Virgin Islands sometimes can be tiresome. I think we all know, you know, about doing business in the Virgin Islands and how the red tape could be, you know, so much a bundle and so tiresome that it discourages you from wanting to do things, especially the younger people who would want to start businesses, etc. I got another text that come in. We need to have Virgin Garda Port, to have a fire department. Okay? I think they're talking about the fighting capability of the Virgin Garda Port. I don't know. I would have to look around when I go there myself, but I don't know that they don't have. But I would agree with the person that texted that if they don't have, they need to take it into consideration. And ladies and gentlemen, that speaks a lot about safety and how we plan, you know, for our own safety, whether at the workplace or at an institution. And safety issues are no small issues. They're very serious issues, and they should be planned properly and executed properly. I myself am a safety officer. I have UK certification in safety, and there are other people like myself throughout the territory. So, you know, we need some in some instances to step up the quality of safety inspections and providing safety apparatus, etc. At various places. So I must agree with you on that, the person that takes that. Also, we need to encourage the ferry services to have wheelchairs. All right, this person really shooting me with some ideas. Not only should they have wheelchairs, but they should have proper policies in place about refund, about how you're able to exchange tickets, etc. I think we as consumers we have to demand a bit more. There's no reason why our ferry operators can't have agreements among themselves as to dealing with each other in times when they have no service, one, or in times when a person might miss one ferry and have to take another ferry, etc., etc. We are not living in a vacuum. These kind of business arrangements, they're possible with a number of operations. So I would encourage our ferry operators to do likewise. And ladies and gentlemen, this may be difficult for some of us to swallow or to comprehend. But even some type of government intervention might even be necessary to assist some of the ferry operators in making their lives and their livelihood and their business more profitable and more reliable. And I'm going to mention the word that nobody wants to probably talk about, and it has to do with compensation. Maybe it's time that we value the service that these operators are providing and have some sort of a monetary agreement with them for service. And that's what I think might be possible somewhere along the line. These are the type of things we need to start talking about and looking at it from a risk management point of view. Without the service, what would happen? How would we fare without the service? And to ensure that we always have the service, maybe we need to look at some serious mitigating measures that would ensure that the service is more concrete, more permanent. I even spoke with some of my colleagues the other day, and we talked about look at what happened with the ferry service between St. John and St. Thomas, where the government intervened. And, 30, 40 years on now, you can see the fruits of it because it is still a vibrant operation and it's working. And it's still able to keep the price pretty much reasonable for quite some time. So, yes, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes you have to take small steps in order to be able to make giant steps. You have to start with some baby steps. And by taking those small steps, you get other people on board, and other people on board, allow you to make those bigger or those giant steps. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, I promised to talk a bit about the water situation. I understand that we're in a situation now in Virgin Garda, and I'm pretty sure in the coming days or week we will hear some further resolution of that situation. There are a number of persons that have spoken to me personally about it and said that they think that, it's not good for the territory. I personally feel water is a human right, that you should have access to water, to the point where I would even go so far to say that in some countries, I've done my research to see that in some countries, namely South Africa for one, there's a minimum amount of water that you get from the government for free, and then after that you pay. I don't know if we are so bold to be offering anything to our citizens in a tangible way, But it is a way of showing, you know, that we care and that we you know, water is life. You need water for cleanliness. You need water for cooking. You need water for bathing. Water is an essential, and I plan to engage people from the water to talk more about water and to explain the system to our citizens much more than we're doing right now. By the way, ladies and gentlemen, those numbers that I gave you the last time I was here, 468-5766 and 468-5834, those are the numbers for the water and sewage department. If you see water running anywhere, in the street, in the road, that is all water. That is water that we have already purchased. Please, do me a favor. If you don't want to do yourself a favor, do me a favor. Call the number. Call them up. Use your cell phone. Call them and tell them the location and what you have seen with the water being wasted. Because that water is all water. And we the taxpayers are the ones who have to pay for that water eventually. Have another text. This is a text that came in. Is the Bywater contract looking any better in your opinion? I don't understand. I'm going to try to answer that, but I don't understand why if it's looking any better in my opinion. I always thought that the Bywater contract was a contract that would provide us with something that we never had before, and I'm seeing that being fulfilled. I'm referring to tertiary treatment of sewage going into the ocean. I was one of those persons who protest when we didn't get any support from persons in power to speak about the contract that was in place at the time. There was I knew all of the people who were protesting, and there were a handful of people. So we know what we have. We know we have the contract now in place. It's almost halfway, and I am glad that we're going to get tertiary treatment. I don't know if that answers the question. There are a number of other issues concerning the contract which we raised some 7 years ago. One of them has to do with the purchase and sale. That's a whole other issue. And lately I've heard persons speaking about ownership of the various plants, etc. And then there's the price. And the price has a formula for different islands. Different islands have a different formula. And, you know, so it's a very difficult question to answer right now. But all in all, the fact that we are going to get tertiary treatment of sewage in the very short future, I think is a tremendous step for the territory. And if we go back to one of my original thoughts on transfer of technology, by this transfer of technology, we should have been able to learn, if only one thing, that it's possible. And the technology that came in to do it, we should have been there with camera every step of the way to document what was done so that we can do it again. And that's my take on the scenario. I can't speak for Bywater. I know the gentleman in Chad myself, and I'm sure if he's given the opportunity, he would tell you everything about what the company is doing. And so far from what I've seen, they produce water and they're now producing plants that would do tertiary treatment of sewage in not so long from now. So if I answer that, I hope that gave a fair enough answer. Another text again. What can we do to decrease the cost of living? Oh boy, you really got a hard question for me tonight. To decrease the cost of living, that's a tough question right now, because if you look at the things that dictate our cost of living, number one, that index that we're forced to use, which is a economic indicator of the country's wealth, And that is so high. Our cost of living index is somewhere, I think it's 41,000 or something like that, which is when you divide the money that the country produces and the citizens, and when you divide, then there's an average that dictates what each person in the territory is actually worth. It's a bit skewed because some people make a lot more than some people make, and it's also skewed because some people make little of nothing. So, you know, it's skewed a bit, but 41,000 is a pretty high number. And out of that 41,000, we're expected to go to the supermarket, have transportation, take care of children, etc., etc. So my advice to you would be to be as careful as you can. Don't splurge too much. You know, don't spend what you don't have, and try to make the best of it. That's from a personal level. From a government level now, I think if we make more money available to persons, I mean more money in your and my pocket. In other words, work with our economy in a way so that we have more disposable income in our hands. Then that money would trickle down into the rest of the community because we would do more things like going to the theater and supporting more cultural activities, etc. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to have to take a break for the sponsors that made the show possible. I'll be right back with you. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, I'm back with you after a short break. Before I left, we were talking a bit about the cost of living, disposable income. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, of course, we're still going to be pushing for this minimum wage. We're still hoping that we're going to see an increase in the minimum wage. I am one of the persons who have been talking about minimum wage for quite some time. And one of the reasons for talking about it is the fact that persons cannot live on the present minimum wage that we have right now. And we're hearing cases of abuse of the minimum wage. So if the minimum wage is so low and people are abusing it, imagine, you know, what would happen if you had a proper minimum wage and persons would feel more comfortable working. They probably work harder. They probably would contribute more to the economy. They even pay more taxes. So there's a number of good reasons why we should push for persons to live a better life and have more meaningful contribution to the community. I don't agree with the negative comments about the minimum wage that, if you increase the minimum wage, then companies are going to have to close down. And, if you increase the minimum wage, that the employers are going to, you know, feel more pressured and that kind of stuff. I think, in having good conscience and ethics in business, you should want to pay a person, at least some money that they could take care of their families. So, and also too, we should be mindful that we're a community that came out from slavery, where there was this discussion would not even be had if it was in a slavery condition. So, let us be more proactive and look after the well-being of those less fortunate than us. Let us look at making the minimum requirements for living in the territory substantial or even sustainable, meaning that it is something that can happen, that, you know, by the time the person gets the minimum wage and they buy the groceries and they pay for the transportation, and they still have a dollar or two left in their pocket to go to the horse race or to go to the movies or go to the cinema or rent a DVD. And that's what we're talking about when we're talking about having a minimum wage, not a balanced book for a cooperative government or a cooperative entity that looks to see how much profit they're going to make for a year, but more that we're humble and we understand that people have to survive and people have to live, not mere exist. Existence is not an option in our community at this time, I don't think. I think we're talking about people living their lives, living comfortable lives. And being mindful that we invite a number of persons among us to live. And when persons come here to live among us, we must hold them to those same standards that we have, you know, that we have come to live up to. So we wouldn't want persons among us to be living at a lower standard or to a degraded standard, because eventually those same people would also, have problems in our community, and we would see an increase in the needs of the social services of our territory. We are already seeing an increase in the amount of persons requesting assistance from the social services, be it the government social services or private social services. We know we have both. And if this is a trend, if this is going to continue, then we have to put the safety nets in place. One of those safety nets is a minimum wage, a livable wage, so to speak. We live in a community where the prices keep on escalating. The taxes keep increasing. And the salaries don't increase, and the minimum wage has been stagnant for I don't even remember how many years. I know it's more than 10 years, more than 15 years, and some of us are going to continue to push for it, and hopefully our voices wouldn't just fall on the rocks, but they might fall on good soil and grow and people might listen and heed and correct the situations. It's not a healthy situation to have persons, having to work two or three jobs just to meet the requirements of their home and their household and their family. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, we need to be proactive with this marriage situation where I know there's a lot of talk about the current U.S. situation with the marriage, but let's talk about our own situation here with the marriage, where we have a situation where there is no advantage to being married as far as the government is concerned, as far as taxes is concerned, etc. We used to have a situation where you could jointly file for income tax and stuff like that, which we have abolished. In other words, the benefits that we had in this society of being married have been eroded over the years, and now we're seeing things that might affect us coming from the UK and coming from the US that are totally in the opposite direction. But what have we as a people been doing to safeguard those attributes of marriage that are positive and meaningful? Have we been doing anything? I think we need to ask ourselves those questions, and we need to have those answers as well. And I am of the opinion that we need to strengthen those things that existed before. We need to put some of them back in place to ensure that marriages work and that people have meaningful communal activities in the country. So that's my take on that, ladies and gentlemen. You may not agree with me with some of it, but that is how I feel. I think we need to put more emphasis back into the privileges and the values of marriage that we had before, and have more advantages to it rather than disadvantages. So I don't know how many of you agree with me, but that is That is what I think we should do. And sometimes when you see things going in one direction, and you really look in hindsight at what we have been doing to preserve the same thing that is being destroyed, you may see that we have been doing nothing. So if you have been doing nothing, you must understand that we don't live in a vacuum. Over time, things will change. And the best change is the change that we want, that we the people want. That's the best change. So let us be proactive and work on the things that we want to change and ensure that there are positive things in the community, so that we are all, you know, the beneficiary owners of these things. Ladies and gentlemen, we're having a talk with the community. We're speaking about, you know, topical issues in the community, and we're hoping that we're able to dialogue as much with the people in the community to the extent that we have a meaningful dialogue from all the way from Antigata to Josh Van Dyke. Instead of recapping, we've been able to speak a bit about the water situation. Again, I'm going to put those numbers out there again for the water and sewage department. If you see water leaking anywhere in the territory, especially in the roads, they've been having some challenges with having water leaking in the road. It's the numbers are 4685766 and 4685834. And ladies and men, don't look in the new directory, because I looked in the new directory and I saw the same old number in there. These are the numbers that you need to call. You need to call these numbers that I'm giving you, because the numbers in the new directory are not correct. I have a text. Let's see what this person here is saying. There are still too many persons riding these scooters without helmet, and if I might add, reckless too. Okay, the whole scooter issue is a whole long issue. Thanks to our government doing good job on the road so far. Somebody that put in a text there, so for that, yeah. Good evening, you're speaking, man. Go right ahead.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Support. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm all right.
Okay.
There's two things I want to touch on tonight.
Okay.
The last thing, I was reading a blog a couple days ago. I think yesterday. Mm-hmm. Where the government had them care, I think, in November or September, or something like that, mm-hmm. to decide that the land
Well, I agree with you that we should have a serious dialogue about it starting from now, because from my point of view, what I've been made to understand by it is we are being forced to produce a register of owners. Of the various companies that do business with us, etc., right? And if you look at the entire industry, you're talking about $160 million a year. And to lose an industry like that would be devastate the country. That's what I think. You're looking about losing half of your budget in one instance.
And I tell you that shortly.
Yes.
All the crew are the same services working in the house.
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe when you can come down to them and maybe to send down, maybe to send them and find out whether the passengers are okay. You know, I guess I assume that they're honest, all the passengers are the same person.
Okay.
And none of the passengers, none of the crewmen will come down and say, okay, tell the customer there is in case an emergency, how you put on your life vest. And not everybody on the ferry, not everybody is going down now to put on a life vest. Even a lady, kind of lady, took a panic in case an emergency or anything or something like that. And nobody, none of the crewmen come down and say, well, this way in case an emergency, this is the way you put on your life and style life vest around you. And I think that is very, I think that's very important. And I don't see that happening with another with the ferries. And I think the lack of the emergency, that's something happened.
And that's a good point you're making. It's also true too that with different life vests, they put on different. They have different ways of putting them on.
They need to come down. The crew.
Yeah.
So they just come sit uncomfortable up in a warehouse. Then came the boat, got at St. Thomas, and then come on the rope. We need to do some dialogue on the ferry when the boat leaves the dock to make sure that the passengers know how to use the life vest, because not everybody on the boat can swim.
That's true.
In case of emergency. You know, another thing I don't see the ferry doing. I know I come out here, I see a ferry full of guests or something, and I never see anybody come to where I come. I never see nobody to other ferry welcome the guests on there, welcome to the fast ferry, or welcome to the rest time. And something I don't see them do that. And I didn't say for why. That's been very sometimes every month.
That's
I don't see them do that. But I know when I come to Tatora, I know that you got to work on the dock.
Yes.
But I don't see them doing that sometimes when I work with, welcome to the fast ferry, and welcome to so many kids. You know, I don't see them doing that.
Well, I know the BVI Port Authority have a policy where they have persons that greet you, even coming from Virgin Garden now. I noticed that people there.
Another thing, right? We've been speaking about it now for ages and ages and years, paper and this and that and stuff, right? Okay? This ferry service has been around now for 40 years, 30 years or more. So the lick that they're getting, the lick that they're getting right now, they shouldn't be getting this kind of lick. This should be up in front of the game. They should be up in front of the game. This should be have government and this and that. They should be up in front of the game. They should be different, having these kind of licks. Starting at the yesterday, you know, they know baby just born yesterday, or today, yesterday. They've been overfed long time, overfed, and they should have been, management of those ferry companies should be really advanced in the game. They should have been telling them what to do for what they shouldn't do for them, because they should be in front of the game. That's what management
came
up for.
Well, I agree with you. But at this point, it needs some kind of intervention, though. You need to get them together and sit them down and find out the problems, the financial problems, the management problems, the human resource problems, the customer service problems. All of those problems need to be put on the table.
Not sometime I'm back with the premier and the government already, vote for themselves, make sure we and then they meet with the government. So then, I don't know what is the issue, but then I think I met with the government, and then number one, we would say, we saw that again from St. Thomas, because I worked in Birmingham, I worked with the federal agent in the U.S. and America. Federal in the U.S. is different than the U.S.
Yeah.
I think it was Governor
Farrelly who put the legislation in place to force them to cooperate, because if you remember the way it was, if you were one person on the dock, those guys would have turned back just to pick up one person. Now you have ferries leaving a specific time from either location, so you don't have a problem.
Yeah, I went to the Caravan down the lane. And I saw the family in the club, and I saw people running, running. And once you heard us say in the club, once you heard us say, is it me in a club or not? And you heard a crew, the crew who saw the boat, they turn it back to you. And I saw it happen in Angola, I saw it only here, and I saw it happen in Angola too, in Angola. People say, you turn the car away, just for the phone, not. When you heard it, but in a club, it didn't mean, the mean exactly in a club, you didn't get it, and I said, we want to come in, they turn it back to you. It's not turning back to you. The same thing in LA, you know, if you don't be in a club with 12 hours before, what does that mean? You know, it's not happening to you.
Yeah. We're calling, we're having a nice dialogue, but guess what? I'm out of time.
Have a pleasant night.
So you have a pleasant night as well.
Thank you.
All right. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, I would have to appeal to engineering to extend the time because we're having such a wonderful conversation. But guess what, ladies and gentlemen, we're out of time. And as I usually say, it's time for the person that make this show possible. It's a great show, and we had very good dialogue, a lot of texts, a lot of calls, and we love these Virgin Islands. And I, as I usually say, this time, God bless these Virgin Islands, and we'll see you again next week.